Welcome to day three of the Lightning Talks. Today we have about 9 speakers. Those of you doing the math, that's about half of yesterday, so we will actually finish on time.
Maybe.
And as a reminder for the advertisements, you might want to consider, where are you eating dinner tonight or tomorrow night? And are you being a tourist tomorrow and trying to go somewhere? I know at least 3 different groups are forming and will be mentioned up here, but if you have something else planned, see if you can find some friends. And now a quick word from Wendy.
Our sponsor.
The technical staff, who deserves another round of applause. Asked me to help when the lightning talks are over to take all the blocks of electricity from the floor and put them back on the table. If you all are sitting, take away the block, take away the duct tape, throw away the duct tape, take the box to them, you're done in a minute. Thank you. That's all.
Side, there's a button.
Mike.
This was a speaker move.
Thank you. Hello everyone again. So, several years ago, in 2013, I did a lightning talk on the AppZero. You might remember that, I was in the same t-shirt. during that time, I told you that it was not my way to grow, and I told you how I become a pro programmer. And today, after 4 years, I want to continue and tell you what happened during that time. This is mostly how community affected me as a pro programmer and as a person in the whole. So the first my event was the YAPSE Russia 2009. And I first saw one of the famous people in the pro world. It was this guy, Brian Dupuy, and I made a picture with him and posted it to my Russian LinkedIn site. So I have a picture with Brian Dupuy there, which is absolutely cool. And after that time, I was visiting several conferences in Russia, Ukraine, and other places. And finally, 2013, I made pictures with many other people. Even this guy. So I could update my resume, but I didn't. Oh, this guy too. Who is it, you would ask? This is actually creator of Lua language, and how does it relate to Perl? It doesn't. But it's just a funny picture. So in 2014, I went to London Perl workshop, which was pretty cool because there was an anniversary and Mark Eaton got a silver camel that time. It was a pretty cool event and I saw a lot of nice people. And when I noticed like these glass bottles on the table with water in them, first my idea was, oh, is it already time for water? Because water was not very common for me. Many nice people I met there and some other creators. And I was really impressed by how English people buy rounds and sometimes disappear after that and change pubs when they're closing. And Wendy was there and taught me to drink Belgian beer. So the next year, when I came to Potsdam conference, I knew what to do. So the next year, it was YAPSE Europe and Granada too. And there was the warmest community I've ever met, literally. It was about plus 30 degrees every day. There were nice sights and nice drinks and tapas and nice people. No, there were not just Japans there. I found a Russian-speaking guy from the US, which surprised me a lot. Nice talks though there too. After that, I decided that I need to organize my own event. And in Rezan city where I live, I organized the first Russian Perl workshop. It's how it worked. And this device is how we made the video of it. It didn't work. Yeah, we called 8 people over there, which was pretty cool for my city. It was the first one in this city. Okay, so 2016. Awesome, 2016 was also nice. Lots of books, lots of nice t-shirts, lots of beer, of course. This night, Bulgarian whiskey was also involved, and when I came to my hotel that night, the first question from hotel staff was, breakfast? Next year there was Yapsi EU in Buznapoka, and I made my very first talk, full talk in English, and the second one day later. One of them was better, one of them worse, no problem. Okay, there was lots of socializing. I found a Russian-speaking Romanian guy at the time. After that, I organized second Russian pro workshop in Rizan. 12 guys. No photos, just videos. There was Rizan PM organized, kind of. This year, TPC EU in Amsterdam, I met Brian Defoy and heard the best presentation, the best training talk I ever heard in my life. A lot of socializing. No Russian speaking foreign guys yet. Please come if you are here. And IT workshop and design is ongoing. So achievements. I made a lot of new friends, many places, visited more coral and IT knowledge. Tried myself as a speaker and even as an organizer. Drank a lot of beer and to be continued because there is a beer in the world yet. So one question that was asked during today's keynote. What brought you there? What is the nicest thing about Amsterdam? I think that this question really touched me very seriously, and I didn't expect it myself. But what brings me there, apparently, and to all the other events, is people. And sometimes other creators. Thank you.
Okay, so when we're talking to audience, next year, 2028, gibt es der 20. deutsche Workshop. Aber wo und wann? Okay, wir wissen nicht alles, aber der Plan ist Köln im Frühling. Wenn es gibt neue Nachrichten, sehen Sie auf Twitter auf Köln Workshop. Danke.
Hi, hello, my name is Andrew, and probably you saw that there was some streaming on Facebook these days, and some statistics, there were over 2,000 views of all the videos, so like the conference has about 300 people and 2,000 views was for them. So Mark talks about Pearl Six Books season 2. So the second season of Pearl Six Books is already now, so yeah, as you all know, Pearl Six was announced about 2000, and after that, there were a few books appeared almost immediately. These two books, and actually now they are outdated. If you, also there was one book I even don't remember the name on Amazon. It was never published. It was the book about Pearl Six. So it followed the trend about what people thought about Pearl Six appearance at those days. And probably also seen this imagined timeline of Pearl Six. So there was a hype, and there was despair, and then like 2006, and this graph ends in 2007. But after that, there was another decrease. So I think something like immediately, like there was at least for my figure, there was no interest at all, and it continued until about 2015 when Pearl Six release was announced, and after that, really people were much more interested than 10 years ago. And if you talk to people, I was talking to people here on this conference, and people really say that it's really fast, even if it's kind of slow, but it's fast enough to understand how it works, just to test all the things you want to test. And also, I have my own story, so I was trying to make some like hundreds or maybe thousands of small examples run it more rapidly. And it actually, since 2000, 15, it never crashed. So it was crashing like every time 10 years ago. Now it's so stable and so fast, so I would like to thank all the Roku developers. But also, what you maybe didn't notice, there was another increase on another layer. So Perl 6 became really like already kind of 6 plus or 1.7. So it's not the Perl 6 that was 10 years ago. If you look at some of those books which were published 10 years ago, then you won't find many, many subjects which are available in Perl 6 now. And this year, there was in the beginning of this year, there was a Kickstarter campaign opened by Brian DePoli. He was going to, he did. He collected some money for.
Oh well.
It's a bit. Turn it sideways.
Brian DePoli, there was about 500 people who donated money. I don't know when the book is published, it was really a good time to collect. Thank you. So after that, I decided that I want to be the first, even despite the Brian collected more money than. So I published my book. So yeah, it was a really nice experience. Actually, I would recommend everyone to just write blog posts or whatever, because you will just learn Perl 6 when you try. So, Think Perl 6, there was Lorraine also was presenting here, another book, quite thick. And there was another book by Moritz Lenz. Actually, it was originally called Perl 6 by Example. He was publishing it electronically, but then it was on paper. So some statistics from Wendy. At this conference, there were about 100 books sold on Perl 6. So again, one third of the attendees bought this. He made a website, perl6book.com, where you can choose which book you want to buy. And I'm also working on another book. Gabor also started his campaign for crowdfunding the book. Moritz started another book about regular expressions or just regular exists in Perl 6. So like 10 years ago, everyone should write his own chat or CMS or log engine or in Perl compiler. Now everyone should write his own Perl 6 book. So this is how it is. And I know more people in this audience who are working on that. One side note, so this is the cover of his book. And these are old books. So you see, Perl was considered like old, but this round expensive thing, Perl. There are many books with this strange thing, even this. And I found who was, you might know that Perl might be called like this, or there was another named Gloria, according to internet. And yeah, I found this one with big Perl. It's 1999. There's another book that is going to be really soon, like next month maybe. So thank you very much.
Lost and found, a bag of games.
It has in there
10 euros.
15.
It has in there hack-mack.
George?
My real thing. Are you done yet? No? I'm doing a walking tour tomorrow of something like 4 or 5 hours for Amsterdam, starting at the Spui, at the United Book Center, which is 12 o'clock. Dutch Americans call it Spui. It's S-P-U-I. 12 o'clock, it's called. We call it Spui. That's all. Thank you.
Hello everyone, I'm Ben Thornlands, and I'm going to tell you all to upload your slides to SIBA. Now you may wonder, If you're a speaker, then you may notice that there's a field in ACT for like URL for your presentation, but everyone seems to upload it somewhere else, and a lot of people don't seem to upload it. So recently I was thinking, I was like, why wouldn't we use CPAP for this? We already have a place to upload stuff to. It's a centralized place, and it actually gives us opportunities to, for example, integrate these slides into Medicine Plan in the future. And since there is no obvious better place, I would say upload it to CPAP. And of course, because I have to do something crazy, I'm going to do a live demo doing just that to all my slides. Because what can possibly go wrong? Especially when you haven't tried it in advance.
Font size is going wrong.
Like a D-O.
Yes.
Control plus.
Apple G plus.
So here, in just one command, I'm slowly uploading all my presentations of the past 5 or 6 years to see. Thank you for your attention.
Which kind of brings the Moo.js, Moo.oo to JS, and that inspired this. So, go on. Those of you who use Moo probably have attribute declarations that look something like this, overly verbose, and it's kind of hard to actually spot the special parts of each attribute. The new module, Moo.x short has, makes all this a lot shorter. The lazy attributes not only require the name and some kind of attribute for the builder, can be one if you don't want to have a sub there, does the same thing as if you say builder one in Moo. The read-only, read-write protected, and read-write attributes only require the name and are required by default. If you are sure you don't want your attributes required, you can add or override the options easily by just appending them. And since there's still a lot of typing, you can just use Moo, it'll load Moo and Moo.x short has for you. It also works for roles. And all three of those are on CPAN now, so please try to break them and have fun with them. Thank you.
Hello, if anybody would like to join me or invite me to the Tutan Jam on the Lookout Tower, where you can swing 100 meters over the ground just after this session, let's meet over there. Thanks.
Okay, Wendy mentioned the Core survey. We'll have had an email from Barbie. Of particular interest is if this is your first YAPSE, your first conference, and you're new to that, or you're new to Perl as well, your feedback is most appreciated, because the organizers of these conferences are generally pretty old hands. And it's very difficult in that position to work out what was good about the conference for a newcomer, what was bad, what would you like to see? So that Glasgow can be better next year for newcomers, please tell us what a newcomer would like to have at a Perl conference, and we will try to make it happen. Thank you.
Okay.
So soon this conference will be finished and you will go home and make you feel sad. And if you really feel really sad, Then you have a chance in 2 weeks. There is in Switzerland, in Villars-sur-Oron, the Swiss Pearl Workshop for 2 days. And maybe some of you like to join. Thank you.
Chunky will be flying out through Schiphol at some point. About 5 months ago, I went to Schiphol, laptop like usual. Please consider getting all his electronic goods.
Yeah, okay.
2 portable hard drives, camera charger, 2 phone chargers, blah, 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 blah. You've been warned. Be ready for that. Of course, this was all fine. What already tripped him up was the RFID shielded wallet. Thank you.
Packing for this conference, I kind of looked at my laptop and thought, well, it's a bit heavy, it's a bit big, but I don't really want to lug it around the conference, but I still want to write some Perl 6, maybe play around with some of the modules that I know are going to be on display. So I got a tablet. It's nice and light, and it is running Linux under the hood. So, well, you know, maybe I can get Perl 6 running on. I'm sure this will be easy enough. I thought naively. This tablet is 5 years old. It was great when I got it. Now it's starting to creak at the seams a little bit, but it's still functional. And hey, people have done it before. Somebody posted some cryptic instructions somewhere, which I know they're important for something, and I've not figured out where. Somebody said it requires a bit of tweaking. If the authors of this are reading this, or if anybody's tried this before, let's compare notes. Because I know this is possible somehow. So, after a bit of Googling, I found this tool, GNU-root. It allows you to run a Debian-like system on your Android device. It seems to work fairly well, from what I can tell. You've got all your standard tools, Git works, there's a bit of setup involved, but it's alright. There's also this is the newer version. I had some problems with this, more on this later, so I maybe don't recommend using this one. Maybe use the slightly older one. But anyway, once this is installed, it gives you this. So, you create a new root of that, does this, then you log into it, and you get something like this. You've got yourself a Linux prompt. Well, straight the quick and dirty way. And this works. You've got Perl 5.20, you've got a slightly old version of Perl 6 on there. But it works, technically. Look, that's a hello world. So next, I'm going to try and get Zeph up and running. This didn't work. No Zeph. Can't really do a lot without Zeph. So I decided to RTFM, and yep, a better way exists. So let's try it. I got this far. This worked. It even built on GNU-root Debian. And then I got to this bit. This will take ages. Like, seriously, go and make a coffee, go get a beer, maybe go see a Perl talk or two. I did. That's about 3 Perl talks or so. Originally ran into problems with GNU-root Debian. It has some strange issue with permissions and assigning plus X permissions on files. It will pretend to do it, won't spit out an error, and not actually do it. I think it's due to the weird way that my Android tablet is mounting an ext4 file system, representing it as XFAT, and then GNU-root is trying to use it as ext4 again. I don't know. I switched GNU-root easy. That seemed to work. I did use total command of what the file system edges, rw, to run that command, and even then that just covers Rakuda, Brew. If you have anything else that needs to execute, it will fail. So yeah, did I mention this takes ages? Like, I let this run for 3 hours, and then it crashed. I was trying to edit the slides at the same time, and Android will handily kill any background processes if your foreground process needs more memory. And turns out Google Slides uses a lot of memory. Tried again, and it died. So, error 137, apparently. Let's try this manually. Configure seems to work. We're all good. Make then fails with a 137 error. All right, to the Google. 137 error is often due to running out of memory. Okay, I can work around this. So I'm going to try all of the make flags. I'm going to try Android tuning. I'm going to try changing the make file. No. Still nothing. Screenshot fails. It took me an embarrassing long time to figure out why it was failing. And then some magic happened and it all started working perfectly just in time for the presentation. And I got a version there and Zeph works and everything ends beautiful. I just happened to not have a screenshot. Screw it, I guess, but why? Why not? Don't want to log a huge laptop to a lock conference. Coding on the go, always nice. Maybe you've got an old phone that's looking for use. Or maybe you want to run a production. I dare somebody, seriously, do it. Why not? It's fiddly. It's slow. It's not battle tested. Here be dragons, as you can see. Might require roots, I'm not sure. Actually, don't know really nice. Also, oh, seriously, this will do unspeakable things to your battery. It will kill it fast and painfully. So anyway, my kind of progress on it is here on Git. It will change. I'm going to keep tweaking this, but watch this space. Thank you.
Understand it. German Pearl Workshop next year is planned to be in Cologne in spring. There isn't a firmer plan than that yet. When it is, it will come on Twitter on the user account Pearl Workshop. Thank you.
Yeah. Oh, cool.
Okay. For tomorrow, I will organize a trip to a museum, a bit lesser known museum in Amsterdam, which is also open for Dutch people if they want to join in. And I will show you a little bit about it. I hope some of you, or no, I'm sure many of you, like art a little bit. So if you have a day off, you may join us on the trip. Now let's see if I get my presentation on the right screen. No, it's not the right screen. Is this just going off my timer?
Jeffrey, go on.
Okay, so I will show you a few slides about what you can see in this museum. So maybe this is attracting you to go with us. Like this, maybe you recognize it from your art books, Picasso, and so on. So Jeff Gogh is being painted by Gogh. Sunflowers, you may recognize this. So if you want to see those things, you may join me on the trip. There's about 4,000 statues and paintings. Very famous paintings, mostly around 1900, collected 1900. It's an, here, oh yeah, this is scaled as well. It's in here where my arrow is, I hope you can see it. So it's very close to Amsterdam. Well, it's close to them. It's there. It's for the Americans. You can go there by train. It takes you an hour, so it's the same time you need by metro from Harlem to Queens or something. So it's very close by. I pick you up at the railway station in Arnhem, and then we go first by car a little bit, and then by bike, because it's a nature area, and you can cycle there by bicycles. So if you're interested, contact me, and I'll arrange the whole trip tonight, depends on the day, the time you have, and so on. And,
tell me about the stairway to heaven there. In front of the museum, there is a stair that ends nowhere.
Oh, right, yeah. Oh, there's so much. It's a really nice your park. And, it's you know, they have 190 Van Gogh paintings and so on, but there are fewer tourists. You know. And it's close by. That's it.
So this year is the 10 years after we started the Russian Pearl Workshop, which was converted into YAPSI Europe. Well, now again, we have to change the name probably to the Pearl Conference in Moscow. So this year there will be the 10th edition of YAPSI Russia Pearl Conference in Moscow, whatever, on 4th of November. And I think we can make it 2 days. First day is 4th of November, second day is 9th of November. In Ryazan, like a few hundred kilometers from Moscow, there will be a beer party and sauna party, with a regular party. So if you happen to be there, yeah, you can join.
Hello everyone. My name is Bob Posterman, and I work at Zaakstein.nl. And I'm giving this talk because a couple of you came to us and asked, like, you guys are sponsoring this conference, but what are you guys actually doing? So, in very short, we are open sourcing the government. It started roughly 8 years ago when we saw a couple of problems with software in the governments in the Netherlands. It was all closed source, it was very expensive, there was vendor lock-in, there were no use of open standards, everything was on premise, and you know, next Tuesday was only one Tuesday a year, or twice if you were lucky. So we built Zaakstein. It's a process management tool for local governments. We started building it with one local government in the Netherlands, gemeente Bussum. And yeah, we're happy to say that nowadays 25 of our governments are using our product. It's open source, everything is open source. Use open standards, it's only available as a service. We release every week, and you know, other applications can talk to us through our JSON API, so it's nice. The stack we use, of course, Perl, PostgreSQL, JavaScript, Docker, Kubernetes, and Fuga. The way we develop, we work in an agile way. We used to do Scrum, but recently we switched to Kanban. The process of development goes a little bit like this. There's a government, several governments, who are asking for a feature. I sit down with the development team, we discuss the cost of the feature. We publish the cost on our website, and local governments can join in for a bit of money, and when we get enough funding, we build the feature, we release it, and everyone can use it. Very nice. Our future, we want to change from monolithic to small web services, from weekly release to rolling release, and of course, world domination at the end. If you want to help do important stuff with us, like watching microarrays, you can find us on our website, on GitLab, and of course on Google Maps. So, thank you.
So, I'd like to advertise something, especially for the Russian guy who hasn't changed shirts in 4 years. I'm not a foreigner speaking Russian, so I don't speak Russian, but I have booze. And I will introduce you to Chartres if you catch up with me.
Sir? Do you have a plan for where?
No. I have no plan for where, I have no plan for when, but it's tonight.
And I have two bottles.
While he's finishing up, we've already heard of two plans for what to do as a tourist tomorrow. One is going an hour away for Smart, and the other is walking around for 4 or 5 hours. I have door number 3. I'm planning on meeting over at the Best Western, which is next to a tram stop for number 2, heading into town, stopping at the flower market. It seems to be semi-famous. Walking across the skinny bridge, which I see in all the movies, and then going to the Dutch Resistance Museum, because 9 years ago we could go to the Danish Resistance Museum. Rumors has it he's one country in the world maybe needing a resistance in the near future. Might as well learn.
Alright, I'm Julian, and I'm going to talk about how to teach programming using Perl tonight. This is the touch tab. Actually, hello? This is not working. Now it's working. Actually, I'm gonna teach. Gonna tell you how to teach people to become developers and how I do that. I've been doing that for about 6 years, and I'm doing this talk for Finn from Shadowcat, who left, unfortunately. So bad luck for him. So who of you is a developer? Raise your hands. That should be most of you. There was someone claiming to be a manager. So okay. And who of you has been trained as a developer? That's considerably less, that's okay, that's good. But who did that not in a university of those ones? Who did not go to university but still is trained? That's even less. And who of those is German? Like Daxim and Malka, and that's it, okay? And over there, oh yeah. So what I did is an apprenticeship that's big in Germany. It's like this 3-year thing where you find work and then you go to school at the same time. They pay you not a lot. And usually people come directly from like regular school, they're like 18 to 20 years old, and they don't have prior tech knowledge. Okay, so who of you has any trainees or apprentices or anything who's training anyone? Is there anyone? Okay, a couple of them, that's good. I think the most important thing to do that is actually motivation. So on my very first day as a kind of like an intern before I started the apprenticeship and I didn't know any Perl at all, I was asked to write a parser for a competitor website with React, HTML. It took me like a day to figure it out, and the next day they put it in production, and that was so cool. It was like I wrote some like code, and it went live, and that was awesome. Couple months later, in school, in the actual school, like this for the apprenticeship, the guy next to me, he asks me, what are you allowed to do? It's like 2 weeks into the apprenticeship, first time school, I'm allowed to sometimes build websites. And I'm like, I deploy stuff to production. Our company makes like a $250 million in revenue. I felt very bad for him. But well, yeah, I was motivated. So I think you need to make those people feel like they matter. You need to talk to them all the time, you need to ask them how they are, you need to get to know them, you need to make them feel that they're part of a team, that's important.
Empathy,
exactly. You let them make contributions. That's very important. They need to be a part of your company, they need to have something to do, especially something meaningful. Because nothing is more demotivating than simply like, hey, this is just us implemented. Hey, here, like, do this quick sort and then we'll throw it away. You need to help them. You need to be available. You need to tell them where you are. Hey, if you need help, I'm going to be over there. Even if I have headphones on, just come and talk to me. It's okay if you interrupt me. I'm here for you. So they need to know that. You don't have to show them everything. In fact, don't show them everything. Just like, let them figure it out and then make sure that they know that they can ask and teach them how to ask. Make them, like help them so they can help themselves. That's very important. You teach them how to use your toolchain, you teach them how to read documentation and how to ask questions, very importantly, how to ask questions. And then you need to work with them. It's like they're part of a team. They're not just like this lowly little apprentice, young kid. They're someone, they're a person and they're making contributions and be working with them. So give them responsibility, give them something useful to do, meaningful. Work with them in a way that when you do something on their project, let them review your code, and then take it seriously what they say. That gives them the feeling that they're also like an actual developer already. So what do you want to teach them? How about this? That's good, I like that. But actually, you don't want to just teach them Perl, you want to teach them everything, kind of. You want to make them a developer. They're not just a programmer. They're not code monkey. They're not there to learn a programming language. They need to learn how to be a developer. So do full projects analysis. Use a ticket system that teaches documentation. It teaches them how to be professional, gives them structure. Like use an MVP, do small incremental user stories. Like as a user, I want to do some stuff because, well, reasons, but, well, they know why. and start small, tiny, because everything is new to them. They're like, they're not developers yet. Make sure they understand everything, talk to them all the time, ask them if they understand, reiterate, and make sure they like the product. So they need to see the value in what they do, so they will come up with their own ideas that will give them intrinsic motivation, and they're motivated, and they like what they do, and they'll be happy. So also make them come to call conferences, take them with you, because you people are awesome, and they'll see that, and they'll be invested in the community, they'll like it, and that's cool, that way you'll get them hooked. So thank you.
Oh, hello. Yesterday I was here telling about another trip going on tomorrow to the London Hackerspace, the biggest one. More details, we'll meet up tomorrow at 1 o'clock at the subway station here, so Henk Sneefiet.
Very good.
So if you're interested to come, just meet up there, we'll be there at 1 o'clock sharp. If you need help or the talk, just take me, get hold of me, I'll be hanging out back here when I'll be here back at us.
I'm talking about something called Giga Shima Ketsan, which is very old, we wrote in 2008. It's still very useful for us. What does it do with Kenny's checksum from the database? I think it's Shima actually. It's a live demo. It's a playback demo. So you have a script, you call checksum on the database, and you get back a checksum. Or you can ask the show dump parameter, you get back a shitload of stuff. And the end, the checksum. So it calculates the checksum of the database. It was 2008. Git was very fresh back then. So we applied the ideas of Git to managing database definitions. So you can use the Shima checksum to update the database schemas. So this operation is to generate a new changes file in one directory and then the database and what wants to change. And then you have a file. And you edit the file. Look at it. It has some sort of header, which is masked as SQL comment. It has some checksum and some other stuff, and then so you write your SQL and change what you want to do, so add a new table. And then you apply the change, but it doesn't work because you don't expect nothing, but it got some other checksum, which is the checksum the database has after applying the change. So it was, but then edit the file again, enter the post checksum, run the script again, you want to apply it, yes, you want to apply it. Post-checks and matches, everything is okay, and database is updated. So it's very nice. It's also nice for teamwork, because we do git pull and you get some other stuff. Then a new file shows up. If you look at it, it has this awesome pre-checks on. The thread looks the same, so you apply the changes. If you want to do it, yes, you want to do it, everything's done. Nice. So database is updated between different developers. There are some limitations. It only works with databases that are actually done changes inside a transaction between Postgres and SQLite. It works on both. Doesn't work on MySQL or Oracle. Other than databases, I don't know. There's no way to downgrade back to older versions, which I never did in the last 8 years. I never had a user for that. Maybe because I write so great SQL. You can still write it if you want to. Just write smarter SQL to convert it back. And so your business plan cannot collect underpants, use the Shima checksum for status Shima management, and then profit. Thanks.
This will be the last of the lightning talks. So if you have an advertisement that you haven't done yet, you want to come up soon, you go right after him. Any organizers in the room, you probably have some place you need to be in about 6 minutes, so figure it out.
Okay.
Hire us all around the world. Oh, good. Drop me an email. I'll keep it short and sweet.
Okay, so I was going to give this talk last year, but and I had it all written, and I was told that it was too early to give this talk. So we're going to give it today. So in June of last year, an announcement came out that said problem relates to Perl 5 Perl. Loading modules from the Enclosed Directory Array, Inc. And by now, most of you are like this, and maybe a little bit of drools coming off your onto the book. Nobody really pays attention when CVEs come out because there's often not a lot of not enough data for people to fully understand the scope of what's going on. So that's the difference between a vulnerability and an actual exploit. An exploit very often very quickly drives home the gravity of the problem. So when the announcement actually came out, it was referring to this. So when Storable was originally put into the core, prior to it going into the core, somebody came up with the idea that, well, we'll try to require log agent if it happens to be installed, which it's not installed by default. And if it is, we'll load it and do an import. So what happens if log agent isn't installed? So it turns out you can put a file in temp called log/agent. And then if you run Perl with Storable, well, nothing happens, right? Well, what happens if your program happens to be run from /temp? Suddenly, you, not being root, have executed whatever code you felt like getting executed later on. So this all comes down to the fact that, as Sawyer explained earlier today, doc was at the end, so it searched through all these. It found that log agent wasn't installed, and it fell back to the doc directory at the end. So the explanation in the announcements was that you, in order to fix this, you need to put this at the top of your programs, begin doc at inc if the end of at inc has doc in it. It would look something like this. And if you do that, then you you don't have any risk, even though you're on older versions of Perl. So when, did I lose the slide? Oops, I lost the slide. So in 5.26, dot is no longer an inc. If you use, we introduce an environment variable called Perl use unsafe inc. And if you do that, then dot is suddenly an inc again. Father Christianos actually complained about this when we were first working on it. Some of the ideas we came up with is, well, if you've got dot in, or if you really need dot, well, maybe you should be explicitly specifying the path. You can use find bin, or worst case, and really, you shouldn't do this. You can put perl5lib equals dot in your hbd.conf. So when we made this change, things didn't turn out so well for CPAM. This, for the most part, is the majority of the problems with removal of dot from inc. People would do things in their makefile PL like saying use lib colon colon my colon colon module, assuming that the lib directory was in the path where makefile PL was being run, and it was going to get picked up because dot was in it. Or they would do t colon colon lib, whatever, same thing. We have patched the CPAM clients to re-inject dot back into inc when you use them, so for the most part, you won't see the problem unless you're running makefile PL manually. The builders also have those protections if they need them. Unfortunately, module install does the trick that we talked about where it says use inc module install. So if you don't have module installed in your system, then this then all the module installs will fail. That's about 10% of CPAM. This is more information on the CVE. If you can, you should upgrade to 5.26 today. Debian fixed the problem in older versions of Perl, so if you have Debian, be sure to upgrade. Gentoo's also done a lot of work on this. And thank you.
And that is the end of our lightning talks.
Really?
A final reminder to all speakers, lightning or otherwise, remember where you put in the description of your talk on the conference website, there is a spot for you to give two URLs, whether you put them on CPAN or not. Please go back and put your URLs and they'll show up in all the appropriate places. Those of you who gave your very first lightning talk, remember we expect big things from you in the future, like in this next year. Those of you who haven't yet, we have 5 minutes for you next time. You have heard of four things going on tomorrow, so please pick one if you're in town, find friends, be sociable. And if you are any of the other organizers, make sure you're not too far away, he might meet you. Oh, for mine, 10:30. Oh, no. I think we were noon for the walking talk. One for the hackathon and
Hackerspace.
And Mark, do you have time for yours? Oh, Mark says it depends on who wants to go, so find him and you'll work it out.
Left, top, middle.
Oh, great.
You had a nice little time, Jeffrey. I got still 15 minutes, or 20. All right. Unicode support, kernel 5.26. I enjoyed the talk. I'm sorry this afternoon. I've seen wonderful things from kernel 6, and I think we can be proud of doing all kind of Unicode stuff. But it goes further. This is me, not because it's over, but I'm feeling much better. This used to be me, not feeling well, and then sorry I came up with this. This is not a good reminder for me at all. And then this year, it's all about the tool community, right? I saw this thing, I couldn't myself, I don't say, but I saw the CloudTag and all our stuff we are going to talk about this conference. And there were issues words that will highlight, and of course there were two things. I said it's all about the Perl community. People ask me what's so special about this conference. I'm not going to say it because people say, nah, you can't live it. Okay. I think it's just an excuse to have a few beers. But it's, to me, it's always about the people. It's not so much of how much you know, it's more about how many people you know, if you know the right people. So there's something going on here. Nils Barkar, Dermot Heikos, Andrew Beverly, Dirk, Dirk Benes, and Kek van Bos. Thank you very much for paying for the most expensive ticket we could find on the website and making it possible for all of us to have our cups of coffee. Your special mug is still waiting for you. Take it with you home. Then, special boring announcements. 7 p.m. we need to have left the building. We should have left this area. You can have some drinks in the place over there.
Until 9 o'clock.
So, we need to get out a little bit. There will be food there. There's an interesting thing they have here on Friday. That's junk food Friday. They will have hamburgers.
But not for all of us. They didn't count us in.
No. So you need to hurry. Some other people will join upstairs. There's a little bit of food left. There's a nice restaurant.
And then, yes, unfortunately, to all good things there comes an end. Yes, I'm sorry. But it doesn't end yet, it doesn't end here. It continues on Twitter. It will continue on Facebook. It will start on YouTube, thanks to Amanda and Sawyer, making sure that all the videos will come along. There is one terrific guy, you will never see him anywhere, I think. I've never seen him anywhere. Barbie, he's the guy that's behind the surveys. Please, and have a winning address. Please fill them in. If you're a first timer, fill them in. It's very, very valuable information. I like to read the reviews from my own talks. I haven't given any talks this year. But I'd really like to see how people stop cursing to me. That's wrong. No, it's not that way. Most people are very kind. But please fill them in. Next organizers will get very valuable information out of it. Then, I already told you on Wednesday morning that we have a lot of people from the Netherlands for the first time here, and I'm very happy to see that. So look out for the Dutch Pearlmongers on Meetup. What else would I say? That's the thing with tiny emoticons. They're so small on your screen. What is this like about? So without the partners, without the sponsors of booking, a tremendous hand for booking.com, they made it for company C-Panel. I'm not sure how I can explain them. Many people are hiring of this list of sponsors, but C-Panel is just the guys that we are so happy to see these conferences happening. We pour in money just for making sure that the conference happens. If you'd like to join the London Pearl Circus of Traveling Idiots, go to Aligo or to Pearl Careers. They will make sure you will find a job there. They have made me move there, and I enjoy London very much. I enjoy very much with these guys from Robin and my colleagues. So here I have already left. Where are my colleagues? They are left. Then this tiny company, Snarky's name, I think they're the kind of Dave and Goliath thing, fighting against these giants of the software house we used to have here in Mass. Very bad hand for them. Cool services and guys, get what? Guys, that's French for that. Oh man, sorry. Yes, they actually have the opportunities. And of course, don't forget Pearl 6 or Willis and Wendy or however they want to be pronounced. This is a very good hand. And then, I think it started 20 months ago. Maybe a little bit more, that my son came to me. He used to have an office up here, and that if you want to organize a Pearl conference, just start talking with the guys of B Amsterdam. And I think they have done a very, 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 very good job. I guess we already have announced Amanda and Sawyer, but there are way more people. It's fabulous to see that they just made an announcement at the Booking Family Facebook web group site thing, and they just popped up the people that were managing the cameras and made sure that everything will be recorded. Thank you very much. But of course, it wouldn't happen without, let's say, Leon, Marijn, Wendy, Erica, please come up, Andrew, Liv, Peter. Yeah.
Don't forget to add the power watch, please.
Oh yeah, very important.